Cocktail Club. As I said, very, very warm welcome. Visitors, usual lot. We alright then? Hello. Right, hopefully you will have your news sheet today, which I have to say, Paulie, this is brilliant. I mean, how many posters and colours can you get on a single piece of paper? It's brilliant! And it helps me because I like pictures. I'm not so good with words, but pictures I like. So there's a lot of information in there for you to peruse and have a look at. Just to remind you, there's still an opportunity to sign up not only for the pastoral course, pastoral care course that happens over a couple of weekends. Just to remind you, church members or members of the congregation do not need to pay for the course, you'll be happy to hear. But I guess even more importantly, the ladies' breakfast is still up. I think it might be 18, 20 plus a sleeping sausage for those that are helping. There's quite a few, isn't there? Very exciting. Also, you'll notice that there is a little sheet for the CBeebies. Thought I might make a few people break up, but that's the Chaps of Broadwater Baptist Church. Sorry for those that are at Chaps. But please, if you know of anybody or you can back, firstly, if you'd like to come to a few events that are happening over the next few months, please let me know so I can sort out bookings, etc. But hopefully, I know we will have a good time. But you'll need to let me know if you want to join in on that time. One other thing is that just to remind people that the all-in service on October the 1st is our harvest service. Collecting again for Worthing Church's homeless. I think it's the usual stuff this year, toiletries and food, but they did say no soup. I don't know why. Or refrain from soup. So if you could think about being some of the harvest service. And finally, there is we're thinking of doing another event for the young people of the church. We had a barbecue fairly recently. We're looking at taking people bowling. That's a choice that I didn't make, but I'm very happy with. But if you could let us know, probably around the 3rd of October. So just be aware, ask your parents, get their money, and get a lift. Because we know you have a problem going. Is there anything I've forgotten? Probably. Anyway, if I have, I suppose it's all in there. Brilliant. All right, I'm going to hand over to the lovely Paul Ryan.
Let's pray as we start our service and bring our time together before God. Let's pray. Father, thank you for bringing us in. Thank you that we have the opportunity to meet, to praise, to learn. We ask, Father, this morning, you will work in our hearts. You will inspire us. And as we come to communion, you'll be with us, strengthen us, so that we may be taken out into the week, singing your glory as a result of coming together this morning. Amen. And we start the psalm. This is from Psalm 34, as we come to bring our praise. I will extol the Lord at all times. His praise will always be on my lips. My soul will boast in the Lord. Let the afflicted hear and rejoice. Glorify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord, and he answered me. He delivered me from all my fears. Those who look to him are radiant. Their faces are never covered with shame. This poor man called, and the Lord heard him. He saved him out of all his troubles. The angel of the Lord encountered camps around those who fear him, and he delivers them.
Can I ask that Pat may just join in the front for the communion?
So let's bring our praise of this amazing God this morning. We're going to start by singing My Light.
So I came up with the idea, thanks to the internet as well, doing about the potato family. So this is the Tater family. Right, you know that a church is very much like a family. And each member of the family is different and has its own special identity and your own personality. So this morning we have a very special family with us to show us how each member of the family may be different and how members of our church family may be different too. So the family that I have with us this morning is the Tater family. And the Tater family is made up of... Paulie, you're going to love this. Dick Tater. Can I have a child to come and be a Dick Tater? Phoebe, do you want to come and be a Dick? The door. So, now, that brings us to the tent of tots in the nursery. I've got a little problem, though. I don't know how they're going to turn out. But they probably will look at the other members of the family and decide that they want to be like one of them. So, they might become a dictator, a sweet-tator, spectator, or an imitator. Let's hope they make the right choice.
Amen.
So let's pray. Dear Lord, as we choose the type of church family we will be, help us to make the right choices, and let us show the fruit of your Spirit in our lives. Amen.
Amen. Thank you very much.
There's some Sunday lunch, isn't it?
We're going to take our offering at this time. Please stand. Let us pray. We do thank you, Heavenly Father, for this family you've placed us in. And as we give of ourselves emotionally and physically and spiritually to each other, we ask that our gifts and talents would be modelled in godly character, that we would allow the fruit of your Spirit working in and through us, so that all that we give would make a difference not just to us, but to our families, to our neighbours and to our communities. Help us to be open and able to see your kingdom grow in more ways than we could possibly imagine or dare to think of. So we ask you to bless us and this offering to you. In Jesus' name. Amen. The children made part. Sorry? I'm sorry, beg your pardon. No, we haven't had the kids for you. Get yourself in a bit of tears.
At least don't be. And because we have, as part of this family that we belong, we follow God, and we've got some great news. The fact that God decided that Jesus could come in God's image and change and save us. So we're going to sing that good news. And this is, I have to confirm, a very jolly song. So we have to be jolly, because it's good news. So, as we were talking this morning, not many of us up here in the band actually knew any actions to this particular song. So what we thought we'd do, we'd try and encourage you to clap along as well, because that kind of generally gets you in the mood of things as well, doesn't it? So we're going to start with Adam's got him to show off his guitar skills, as ever. And we're going to encourage you to start clapping along. And once you clap loud enough, we might start singing. Okay, let's go.
Good morning, everyone. This morning's reading is from Galatians chapter 5, verses 13 to 26. For you have been called to live in freedom. Not freedom to satisfy your sinful nature, but freedom to serve one another in love. For the whole law can be summed up in this one command: love your neighbour as you love yourself. But instead of showing love among yourselves, you're always biting and devouring one another. Watch out. Beware of destroying one another. So I advise you to live according to your new life in the Holy Spirit. Then you won't be doing what sinful nature craves. The old sinful nature loves to do evil, which is just the opposite from what the Holy Spirit wants. And the Spirit gives us desires that are opposite from what the sinful nature desires. These two forces are constantly fighting each other, and your choices are never free from conflict. But when directed by the Holy Spirit, you are no longer subject to the law. When you follow the desires of your sinful nature, your lives will produce these evil results. Sexual immorality, impure thoughts, eagerness for lustful pleasure, idolatry, participation in demonic activities, hostility, quarrelling, jealousy, outbursts of anger, selfish ambition, divisions, the feeling that everyone is wrong except those around you, envy, drunkenness, wild parties and other kinds of sin. Let me tell you again, as I have before, that anyone living that sort of life will not inherit the kingdom of God. But when the Holy Spirit controls our lives, he will produce this kind of fruit in us. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Here there is no conflict with the law. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have nailed the passions and desires of their sinful nature to his cross and crucified them there. If we are living now by the Holy Spirit, let us follow the Holy Spirit's leading in every part of our lives. Let us not become conceited or irate with one another or be jealous of one another. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you so much. Let us spend some moments in prayer. Let us pray. Let us pray for those that are close to us. Thinking about those people that we love and care for. We pray that they would know the Spirit of God in their lives. We pray for those that are dear and close to us, those that we love, who are struggling. We pray for the Spirit of God to work in their lives. We pray particularly for this week for the Groves family. The time of sadness, but also a time of celebration of the life of Andrew's father. We pray that the Spirit of God would work in each and every person in that family. We pray for our church family, those of us that struggle, those of us require a fresh touch of your Spirit, Lord, in our lives. But we also pray for what it is you want us to do as your people, Lord. We pray that the Spirit of God will move in the life of this church. Heavenly Father, you've brought us from many different places to be here this morning. From different streets, and areas, and towns. Let us pray that the Spirit of God would move in those areas as well. If you feel that you can shout out a town or even your street, as we think and pray about those people Father, you've not just placed us in this town, but you've placed us in a world that can sometimes feel desperate, fearful. A world that is full of discord and anger, of hate, fits of rage, ambition. Lord, there are so many things on our hearts, each and every one of us, this morning. People who are suffering because of their religion, those faced with the natural disasters, people who are having to deal with the acts of terror, a flood, a famine, of earthquake. We pray first, Lord, that you would give us a real sense of hope through your Holy Spirit, that there is some sense to all of this. But also, Lord, that we pray that those involved would be changed, that the fruit of the Spirit would move in their lives, that there would no longer be that selfish ambition and rage and anger and envy, but patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control, joy, peace, and love. Because against such things, there is no law. So, Heavenly Father, we offer our prayers, spoken and unspoken, those prayers set in the very heart and depths of our beings. And we pray that we would know your answer. And even if that answer is ourselves, especially, I guess, that we would respond in the knowledge that our God is with us and for us. In Jesus' name. Amen.
We're going to come in a moment to communion. And as we come to eat and drink, let's remember, as we heard our reading and as Jason prayed, that God provides us with strength. His Spirit flows and brings refreshing. Let's reflect that in some of our worship now as well. I'm going to sing a couple of songs before communion. And help us to focus on Jesus, what he's done for us, what he does for us, and how our hearts can respond. We'll start by singing Living Waters. Peace and stand to sing.
Thank you.
Father, we know that you are the source of life itself. We pray that you'll bring refreshing as we draw near. Father, you know how much we long to do your will, that we want to be with you and have you fill us. Sometimes we struggle. Help us as we come to communion to find forgiveness, for us to confess, admit to ourselves that things don't always go right. Help us to commune with you once more. Help us to draw closer to you. May you refine us and transform us from the inside out as your Spirit flows.
I will praise you, Lord.
Let us just quieten our hearts before the Lord now. As we come to this table, a table that we are invited to take and eat, to experience God and to know that He is good. But no matter how we feel this morning, this meal that we take part in is all about what God has done for us. It's not about how good we are, how great we feel, how much work we do, how many times we can bless and pray and offer ourselves to others. This is a table where the Lord has done everything that is required. It is a table we come just with ourselves. We come in the knowledge that before, even before we came to faith, even before we ever imagined we would know God, Jesus Christ died for us. And at that very moment, where our eyes were opened by the Spirit of God, we were able to see how much this table means, not just to us, but to God Himself. And He asks us to come and know this table is about the love He has for each one of us and for this world that we are placed in. So we come, just as He did on the night He was betrayed. And we take bread and we give thanks to God for the body of Christ. This body that as we take and eat gives us sustenance and energy, gives us the very life of God. And that is why He broke it and shared it amongst them all. come to this table in remembrance of the sacrifice that Jesus made, the blood that was shed for the forgiveness of our sins. So let us, in the quiet of our hearts, remember all those things that we wish we'd never said, those things we wish we'd never done, for those words we wish we'd spoken, and the things left undone that we should have done. We do not come to this table defeated. We come forgiven. Not because of our own effort and determination, not by our sheer willpower, but by the blood that was shed on the cross. So we take this cup as he did, and we give thanks, Lord, that you did what was required, that through your love and the blood of Christ, we are forgiven of our sins. And we thank you so much that you are faithful and true. And as we ask for your forgiveness, it is there for our taking. That is why you then share the cup amongst them all. So let us drink together in the knowledge that our sins are forgiven by his blood. Amen.
is so solemn and so special. It's also something that brings great joy. So we're going to sing "Here I Am" as we say thank you for the opportunity to have communion with God.
Hello. My old... It doesn't like
me at all. Hang on. Right, anyway, carry on. It's like being sidetracked. I don't know why we do it. And actually, the word sidetracked, no, it's had it.
Go on.
Is exactly that, isn't it? It's going off the path that we've had, or we were going on. And that can be a very, very dangerous thing to do, mountain climbers or whatever, you know. I mean, people by now should know that I really don't like walking at all. I was thinking of hiring people to carry me around in a sedan chair. I don't think the newspaper headlines would be great. But when you're up a hill and you decide to go down that little track, heaven knows where you're going to end up. And for Paul, in the words that we heard earlier, if you read Galatians, Paul's really worried that it's beginning to happen, this sidetrack, this move away from the path, is happening to the Christians in Galatia. They're in danger of drifting off, drifting away from the gospel. He's looking at the thing, I mean, essentially what he's saying is you're beginning to think this, yeah, Jesus is great. And it's really good that he died for us and was resurrected. And all of that is important, but we must keep certain traditions up, practices. These things are great, but this is just as important. But what that actually means is that sidetrack. What it's saying is, sometimes without realising it, we're saying that Jesus is not enough. So Paul comes to the end of the letter. And I'll remind you a little bit of the letter, because he was inclined to be a bit rude to them. And quite sarcastic, because in chapter 1 he says, I'm astonished that you've moved away. I'll read it to you. He says, verse 6, I am astonished that you have so quickly deserted the one that called you by the grace of Christ and turned into a different gospel. Astonished means marvel at, but I think he was just taking the mickey, basically. He was being sarcastic. What are you doing? And then later on in chapter 3, those famous words, you foolish Galatians. So what he tries to do in all of this is he tries to refocus them, refocusing their minds on Jesus, trying to see that their lives can be used by God, not because of what they have done or the traditions that they have, but because of what Jesus has done already, what he can do and what he's actually still doing. And he talks about freedom and law. Now, I am after a sympathy here. Nothing from him at all. No, I meant it. Because actually coming here on a Sunday morning is a daunting task. Why, you ask? We're such a lovely bunch. We're caring and open and eager to please. But that's not the problem. The problem is this. Both you and I constantly in danger of moving away from freedom to law. From situations of I could to I should. From this is what I want to do to this is what I must do. You see what I mean? There are some things that we just can't help ourselves. And I don't always do this. I'm always in danger myself of feeling that and actually getting the balance right. And that is why I need to do it. Because we have to get this right together, don't we? Amen. Yeah. I'm sure you pray for me. I have lots of things that need prayer. Then just add it to the list now. But you see, Paul in this letter doesn't have a problem. He has the balance right. He knows how to live this life. We do not have complete freedom. But we do not live by obligation alone. We live between those two. One area is pleasing ourselves, and the other is doing what we feel we should do. And the answer for Paul and for the Galatians and for us is actually somewhere in between. Recognising, though, that the only way we can live this life is by the Holy Spirit, by his guidance and by God's grace. So we have two choices, two lives. We can either live for ourselves or we can live for others. I'm
I'm going to reread some verses from Galatians chapter 5. The acts of the sinful nature are obvious: sexual immorality, impurity, and debauchery, idolatry and witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions, and envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. Anybody wish to put their hands up for any of those? Cracking stuff. Really good stuff, that. Because actually, people say the Bible has nothing to say to this world. The Bible has no relevance to daily life. And you get that. That says so much. And they might seem a little bit random, but every single one of those vices, and I use that old word, vice, and it's not one of those things that Titus thinks the whole stuff. They fly into the face of God's commands and his desire for us as human beings. In fact, for the whole of humanity. And these vices are linked to our very own capacity to live lives for ourselves. These set of values, when lived out, actually create a world centered on me and us as individuals. And world equation is built into our lives by living like this. Does anyone know where the centre of the visible universe is? Anyone? No. Ooh. It's here. This spot here. Because I can see the universe, the visible universe around me. Each and every one of you is the centre of the visible universe. How exciting! Because if you look out into the sky, you look around, what you can see is the centre, you are in the centre of the visible universe, the universe that you can see. And the desire for ourselves to be the centre of everything is what, well, it's greater than any other, I think. And if we live a life of pure freedom that feeds into that desire, and what happens is we use others for our own gratification, in whatever form that takes. And we can even use religion and tradition to manipulate for our own ends. We can use all that God deems good for our pleasure and desire. However, there is a second choice. The second life is one that is possible when we share it with the Holy Spirit. And actually something we may not have realised before, that actually when we live that life, others benefit as well. The fruit of the Spirit sounds so good for us, don't they? Sounds so obvious. Doesn't seem to be any surprises when we think about that is a good way to live. However, I am absolutely positive that I did not at any point before I came to faith believe that any of that fruit was good at all. Apart from love, but that's for a whole other reasons. And that's true of Paul as well. When he was writing this letter, the world around the Galatians was living by a set of rules and vices that were not God's fruit. And that is true even now. Humankind has not changed a great deal. We do not live in a culture that values humility, patience, self-control at all. And so what Paul is doing is he's setting out a vision of a very different community. A vision of a place where the values are so radically different to the world's that they cannot help but notice. That is the task of us today. And actually sometimes we can dismiss this and think, well, we are different, aren't we, because we're Christians, first off. We are different because we come to church on a Sunday morning. We are different because we meet with each other. We're very nice and we enjoy this. And we have home groups and we have prayer groups, etc. The list goes on. But actually what we're being asked to do, or what the question that we're being asked is, how different really are we?
We are not meant to be just a group of people meeting together, but we are meant to be a community that is very different to the rest of the world. And the work that we have is this. And if you thought I'd forgotten that this was the second week of fruitfulness on the front line, this is where it makes the difference. Because modelling godly character and behaviour is visible not here, but when we are out in that big, big, bad, scary world where our front lines are. This is where the work of the Spirit is tested and worked out in us. In those places, not here, in church. And actually, the level at which that happens is down to us. It's down to us allowing God to test and refine and bring those characteristics into our lives, to be fruitful Christians. How much we allow the Holy Spirit to work in those difficult places and situations we find ourselves in. And it all sounds really hard. You may ask the question, how could you possibly say this when you haven't met my neighbour? When you have never been with X, Y, and Z? When you've never had to deal with Great Art Moore, who's quite frankly the most person in the world? How is it possible when we try to live through the disappointments at work, arguments in our family, discord in our relationship, frustrations with our friends? How does this work when we are faced with tedious people, stressful situations? You can delete as appropriate. Now I'm going to share something that helps me. And many of you will know that I am constantly surrounded by these sorts of people. Those that annoy and frustrate me. It's none of you. It isn't. It's absolute joy. No, I mean it. I can't stop smiling. I mean it. And I have shared times in my work life where it's been interesting, to say the least. And the thing that helps me is when I get to the end of the day and I think to myself, nothing of any real value has ever happened. I've not really done anything for the kingdom of God. And maybe my attitudes, what's going on? And maybe my attitudes, I didn't think it was that bad. Stop looking at the screen. When I get to the end of the day, I don't think that I've done anything of any real value for the kingdom. When my attitudes have been less than perfect, the difference is I try to remember that it isn't me working in, but God working out. Again, we do think it's all about us. We think that it's through our striving and working out how to be a better person that makes a difference. But the verse says what? The fruit of the... It doesn't say the fruit of Jason, does it? That would be a very different book, a very different letter. It doesn't say the fruit of Alfred, Colin, Nigel, Ethel, whoever you are out there. It doesn't say that. It says the fruit of the Spirit. And the difference is, for me anyway, is remembering that the Holy Spirit has been working in each one of us throughout the day, whether we feel it or not. That when we grimace at that conversation, the Spirit has been working in and changing us for the better. When we cringe at the attitude of our boss, our friend, our colleague, the Spirit of God has been building us in us more of His fruit. When we've refrained from taking part in gossip and we've stood up for someone, God has been building into each and every one of us His character and the fruit of the Spirit. God has been at work in us. But He's also been at work in others. Not just seeing and being with us, but experiencing godly character to whatever degree we show. That character in times of frustration and the times of challenges in our day. Believe it or not, God has been working in others as we endeavour daily to allow God to change us and make us different. All of this is an opportunity for God to change our character. All those difficult people and difficult situations is an opportunity for the Spirit of God to build his character in each and every one of us. Now, there's always been danger of Christians going from one extreme to the other, to being bogged down between being lax and over-religious. There is a fine line between freedom and law. However, when we walk correctly, the Spirit of God will work in us and change us. Change our conversations, our attitudes, our reactions. God is in the business of making a very different community and individuals to that that's outside of the world. A difference that in the midst of the lives that we encounter on our front lines can challenge them to see God is relevant to daily lives. Modelling godly character doesn't just change us, it changes others. It is about God making us countercultural in our reactions, our attitudes, our conversations. Different to how we love, different in being joyous, different being full of peace. As we are patient, as we are kind, as we are overly generous, always faithful, gentle, and able to resist all that the world throws at us. The Holy Spirit does that, not us. Remember, Paul does not talk about the fruit of me, but about the fruit of the Spirit, about us modelling godly character as that fruit works in and through us. Now, I'm wondering, because we've had lots of screen happenings, have we still got the video? That was a big shake of the head. That's a shame. I wanted to share a video, or maybe I'll just talk you through if we find it. And it was a video of a man who lived in Staten Island. Anyone been to Staten Island? Yeah. And he worked in the city on Wall Street. But that's not how the video starts, interestingly. It starts with a man taking a wheel off of a car. And you begin to realise that there's a situation where this fellow has now given all of this up and he now owns a garage. Because he grew up and he learned how to fix cars when he was younger. And he talks about the reason he does it. And the reason that he now works in a garage is he wants to do a good job. You hear him talking, very broad, sort of Staten Island, New Yorker accent, about making the difference in the community that he's in. He talks about treating them with kindness, helping them out when they're struggling. Talks about actually being fair and honest, because we all know the mechanics can be hard, Jack, wasn't it? But he does talk about the attitude that people have to different particular people in their community. And he says, I want to make a difference by being a kind and a loving and a generous and a joyful and a peaceful mechanic. Each and every single job that we do, we have that opportunity to do something different, to model godly character in whatever place we are, whatever job we do, whatever people we come across. And actually, the story of this guy in Staten Island is God worked through him. The Holy Spirit worked to bring about his fruit in this man as he worked for his community. Let us just spend a few moments then in prayer. We thank you, Heavenly Father, that it is not us that works to bring about the fruit in our lives. But we pray that you would open up our hearts and minds to receive your fruit. Allow your Spirit to work in us as we encounter situations and people that make life difficult. Help us to see that you are modelling godly character in our lives. Help us to be open. And Lord, open our eyes to see those possibilities, to see you working through others in us. Help us not to dwell on our own strivings and difficulties, but see that even in those times, you are working in us. In Jesus' name. Amen. Let us stand here and sing our final song, Strength Will Rise. Speaking. Lord, work in us as we go out as your people to see us and this world changed.